Thank you to everybody who, all 400 of you who watched our previous two editions of the online webinar. If you remember, we had covered two case studies on PNG and Meesho, and a couple of other case studies that we had done. A quick introduction about us. We are basically a bunch of corporate trainers. Direction One Online was started because our training colleagues, our participants in the training program, came back and told us that, look, our HR department organizes training once in 6 months, once in a year. Can we continue the learning journey even after the learning exercise, you know, after the training event is over? And the second point was that a lot of people were, you know, exposed to one particular industry. They wanted exposure to other industries also through some relevant practical advice. So that's where this webinar fits in. Direction One Online contains a number of online courses on sales, marketing, negotiations, and leadership. There are basically three ways in which you can access the content. The first one, okay, the first one is there are these pure online courses which you can access by simply logging in, completing a payment process. These start at about 1200 rupees and go on to about 2000 rupees. These lessons contain, they're basically video lessons along with some exercises, and after you complete seeing the video lessons, you can download the certificate and upload it to your LinkedIn profile. The second group of programs that we have is the online certification program, where somebody from our end will track your progress, will track your performance. There'll be assignments that you'll have to submit, and then we'll get back to you with you know, a feedback, and there'll be a few online sessions with industry mentors. All the entire content on the site is available to you at a monthly subscription of 599 rupees, and yes, of course, there's no certificates associated with this third method. All right. Okay, so that's it. Let's move on to the agenda for today. So today we've got two exciting events happening. The first one is that we've got GK Suresh. Okay, so what I will do is I will quickly go ahead and admit GK Suresh into the picture. Hi, GK. All right. So here is, okay. So everybody join me in welcoming GK on this webinar. All right. Hi, GK. Can you make out? Can you hear us? Yes.
Hi, Maneesh. Yeah, I can hear you. And hi to everybody else.
Okay.
And thanks for your time to be here at 5 p.m. on a Sunday evening. It's an unearthly hour to be doing a webinar.
All right. Okay.
These lessons contain basically video lessons.
Okay. Okay. So, all right. So, everybody, let me give you a quick introduction. I'm also looking at my mobile simultaneously so that I can keep track of questions and comments that are being asked. All right, everybody, a quick introduction about GK Suresh. GK and I joined ITC together more than 24 years back. We were a group of 12 people who joined. I was the first one to quit. GK was the last one to quit. All right, so we were a group of 12 people. We called ourselves a dirty dozen. GK was left holding the fort for a long, long time. He finally moved out about 3 years back.
I think the other way to look at it is all the good people left early.
Okay, so thanks for the compliment. That's a backhanded compliment. I'll take that. All right. And all right. So a quick background about GK. He's FMS 95 batch. And, you know, he started with the tobacco division and has been in marketing roles in virtually all of ITC's divisions, right? From personal care, foods, and his last assignment was vice president category, new category development at ITC, handling chocolates. So GK, I remember one comment that you had made to me when we met at Bombay airport, okay, some time back. So every time we used to bump into each other at airports, you used to tell me the new role that you are performing. And when you finally went into the chocolate division, I had asked you a question. I said, what's chocolates? When is ITC getting into it? So he says, what GK had said was that I'm responsible for ITC to find new ways of losing money. Okay, because at that point in time, there was only tobacco was generating profits. All other businesses were making a loss. All right. Okay, great. So good to have you on the session, GK. Thanks for joining in. All right. So let's start. Okay. Message to all the viewers. Keep putting in your comments and questions through the comments. And if there's something specific that you would like me to ask GK, go ahead. We'll do that. All right. Okay, GK. So you've been in the marketing side for over 20 years now. Can we start with what has changed? I mean, what was it 20 years back when you started off and 10 years back and now in these uncertain times, what's new? Tell us.
I think two things come to mind straight away in terms of, I think, what has changed. One is, I think availability of data, particularly, I think, in the FMCG sector. There was a time when FMCG companies did not even know who their consumers were. Essentially, the companies sell to distributors who in turn sell to retailers. Consumers and come and buy from the retail shops. Consequently, you do some studies, what is called as post-launch tracker studies or brand studies, and you get some idea, which of course is a very small sample, based on which you try to kind of figure out who your consumers are. But I think increasingly, with the growth of modern format, with the growth of e-commerce, with the growth of, I think, companies' own websites, social media, and a lot more technology which is coming in, I think there is a lot more data which is available about consumers. And I think the challenge will be, how will FMCG companies use this data to, I think, what I would like to call as mass customization, right? Or customization at scale.
Okay,
I think earlier we just used to use broadcast media, broadcast our message to consumers and hope that consumers like it. What I used to call a spray and pray. So advertise to a large set of people and hope that my target audience is also part of that people. And, you know, they get turned on by what I'm saying about my brand. Mm-hmm. But I think increasingly there are opportunities for us to say different things to different people. We know that all people do not have the same requirements or same needs. And therefore, it's now possible for us to customize messaging to different kinds of messages to different sets of people. I mean, very recently, I remember seeing a Samsung commercial, right? And they had a very different ad for their Galaxy mobile phone for the men. And the ad was very different for the women, because the kind of features that they were stressing on for the men were a little different from the features that they were stressing on for the women. So I think that's one big change that I see happening. And I think this change is very important, because I think otherwise the power is slowly moving towards the modern trade and e-commerce guys. They have all the data. They know who the consumer is, what the profile of the consumers are, what do they buy, when do they buy, how much do they buy, what is the combination of items in their basket that they buy. And as a company, I don't know any of this data. So
is that fear? Is that still the reality today also? I mean, with ITC, or do you think ITC was, fairly well set in terms of its data?
So ITC has data in terms of what we sell into the outlet, but in terms of who buys the products from the outlet, I think ITC is still fairly nascent.
Okay.
And that is where that body of knowledge now resides with the retailers. If FMCG companies don't take steps to rectify this, what might happen in the future is you will have Amazon walking up to ITC, Hindustan Lever, Procter & Gamble, and saying, you know what, I want you guys to launch this particular SKU, this particular price, and provide it with this particular offer. So they will almost determine what products, what SKUs, what flavors should companies launch, because they know, they seem to be identifying consumer trends far earlier than the companies will. So I think that is one big change, which is data is now available, and how will companies start getting this data and using this data to start messaging and understanding consumers better, and segmenting and targeting them a lot better. The second big change that I'm seeing is what I call is ad avoidance. I think with the growth of things like Amazon Prime, Netflix, the do not disturb feature that you have on mobile phones, the whole GDPR that has come out in Europe, and I'm sure some version of it will soon come to India as well, means that people are saying, you know, I'm willing to pay a little extra, even if it means that I don't get interrupted by advertising. And so that's of course a great thing for the consumer, because they get uninterrupted viewing. but that poses a huge challenge for marketers, saying if that be the case, then how will marketers now start reaching their messaging to the consumer? So I think brands, I think, will start moving away from telling consumers who I am and how good I am and why am I better than everybody else, to now start creating content, which is, I think, far more relevant and start telling the consumer how the brand can play a role in the consumer's life. And we're seeing that happening already. We see a lot of brands now working on webisodes, long format films. They're working on branded content in terms of creating their own films. I think Hindustan Lever recently created a Bhojpuri movie, and where Clinic Plus was kind of integrated into the movie quite seamlessly. I think essentially brands will now start almost competing with the other content providers like Star Plus and movie makers and so on and so forth, to create content which either consumers will consume because it educates them, or it entertains them, or it is of some value or use to them.
So the marketeer's job is getting more and more difficult as it goes along. I mean, this is despite, I mean, we were in discussions with some online marketeers recently, and they said even though with Curtsy Geo, the number of screens has gone up dramatically, the inventory, the total inventory, ad inventory available, space available for advertising has actually, you know, may not have gone up to such an extent despite, you know, because people are just forwarding ads, or Netflix and Amazon Prime simply don't have ads at all. All right.
So true, Maneesh. I mean, I always define marketing as like you have AD and BC, before Christ and after Christ. I think there is this after pre-Doordarshan and post-Doordarshan.
Okay.
I think if you see some of the brands which are created the pre-Doordarshan days, there was just one channel, one Chitrahar or one Hindi movie, and the entire family, the whole colony was kind of clustered around the TV watching that, right? So I just needed to ensure that I just needed to place my piece of communication in that one program, and I reach large sets of people. Today, to reach that same one person, I may need to, the media has got so fragmented because the same person, as you said, is watching content across multiple screens, that I may now have to have something going on Facebook, something going on outdoor, something in store, something on TV, something on radio, and hope that, you know, because of all this surround media, that I'm finally able to get the consumer.
So does this mean the number of marketing jobs is increasing? Or, so that would be good news for all our friends who are in campuses. Okay. Would that be the outcome?
Definitely. I think without doubt, I think marketing is getting a lot more specialized. Increasingly, you'll find in many marketing organizations, you have people separately looking at content, separately looking at digital. I think in the future, you will have people who are completely focused on making, let's say, films and episodes and serials and stuff like that. So I think definitely the jobs are increasing. But hopefully the number of consumers will also increase, and hopefully the amount that they consume will also increase, so that you're able to justify the number of marketing job increases that.
And the hundreds of crores that is being spent by large companies on advertising right now. All right. Okay. All right. So can you share with us a couple of instances where you faced some real solid marketing challenges, and what you did in your role to address those challenges?
So of course, the biggest thing that I did was to run away and leave ITC. So that is, of course, one way of tackling the challenge. But
after 23 years, okay, 23 years of tackling those challenges. All right. Okay.
So, but yeah, I mean, of course, lots of interesting stuff that we were faced with on a day-to-day basis. Two things stand out for me, I think. One is when we were launching noodles, we were fighting this behemoth. This big tank battleship called Maggie.
Maggie
had close to 90% share in the market. Lots of guys had tried to shake the hegemony of Maggie, whether it was Foodles, Top Ramen, Knorr, and all these guys, but I think all put together, they were able to garner about 10-12% share at their peak. So it was a big challenge on how do we go out and how do we find those chinks in the armor of Maggi. We spent a lot of time with the consumers, and when we did that, a few, I think, insights emerged for the consumer. In fact, I remember one of the housewives telling my brand manager that, you know, I don't know why Maggi noodles is rectangular in shape and the vessel in which we cook it is all round. And in fact, she went on to say that, you know, that is why in the Maggi ad, they say that you have to break the noodles and put it. Because if I don't break the noodles, in any case, the noodles will not go into the pan.
Container. So that got us
thinking, yeah. So that got us thinking, saying that, is there an opportunity for us to create a round noodles? But round is just a shape. It has to mean something to the consumer. So when we made some prototypes and took it back to the consumer, and consumer is two people, right? One is the mother and the kid. The kid said that, I think it's probably one noodle strand which goes on the food, and therefore I know I can keep slurping the noodles, and you know that is their biggest delight in which the way they consume the noodles.
Yeah.
The mother says that probably it'll have more quantity because I think in terms of surface area, since it's the same quantity but occupies a larger surface area, the mother felt that there could be more quantity. Mm-hmm. So there seemed to be some value in the round noodles to the consumer beyond the obvious shape difference. The second thing we realized that while the mother wanted to do a lot of things with the noodles, and she used to say that I add chicken, I add egg, I add vegetables and so on and so forth, but in reality she only had time to add some tomato ketchup. So that's all she had the time for. But the desire was there to add a lot more to the noodles to the kid, which is why we came up with the idea of adding some dehydrated vegetables into the noodles. And a lot of research went into the size of their vegetables because it had to be small enough so that the kid could not pick it up and throw it out, yet large enough that the mother can see the veggies falling into the noodles when she was pouring it out of the masala mix packet. We also bifurcated the masala bucket. We had an orange noodles and a yellow noodles. We also realized that oftentimes the noodles are served hot to the kid. It's kept under the fan. Sometimes the kid gets a little distracted. By the time it comes back, the noodles cools down. When it cools down, it becomes sticky.
We have this issue at home, at our place, all the time. Okay, even today we have it all the time. All right. So
but you know what?
What should be done with the fan? Why the fan didn't get switched off as soon as the noodles got made? So that's one standing commentary in our house nowadays.
Yeah, but you know what? I think that's the power of big brands, right? So consumers will forgive Maggi. So the mother will say, but that's the kid's fault. Mm. You know, it's not Maggie's fault.
Yeah.
You know, kids should have eaten it when it was hot. Mm. Okay, so that's the advantage of big brand. So so we basically brought in a combination of all this in terms of different options in masalas, dehydrated vegetables, non-sticky, round block. And it required all this effort to kind of take on this behemoth. And over a period of time, so we launched noodles in 2010, late part of 2010. And
how long did this whole research process, talking to the consumer, go on?
I think it took us about 3 years. I think we started work on the category sometime in 2007.
Okay.
It was almost 3 years to do this. Huge number of block trials, a lot of testing with the consumers, a lot of time spent with the consumers. So late 2010 was when we launched, and I think as of last year, EP has a market share of close to about 26-27%.
Wow. Okay.
And Maggi has actually dropped to close to about 60% now.
Okay.
So between these two brands, we are about 90, and all the balance put together is another 8 or 9 share.
All right. Okay. So you're saying, okay, so in terms of, let's say, the learnings from a marketing manager's point of view, a huge amount of pre-launch research into what the consumer wants, what should be there in the product, what is the, what is the way the kid is consuming the product, what is the way the mom is cooking the product, lot of insights from there, right? Okay.
True. And the other interesting thing, Maneesh, is, over the last after I left ITC, over the last couple of years, I've been working with some startups as well. And I think one thing comes through, right? I don't think it matters how much money you spend on research or how many consumers you meet. I think what is more important is the amount of time you spend with consumers. I think the more consumers you meet, the more number, more amount of time that you spend, and spend the time in their context, at the time when they're eating or consuming or using or shopping. I think that is when the maximum amount of insights, consumer understanding actually comes. So I think for me, that was the biggest learning, you know, because we spent enormous amount of time with the consumers. Not that we met too many, but whoever we met, I think we spent a lot of time with them.
Okay. And when did the Maggie controversy happen? You think that happened, that did that affect the sales?
That happened in 2015. And so actually that that's another huge challenge as well that we faced. And I think it actually worked in our favor. I think Nestle took time to respond. Not that I don't think Nestle was a problem at all. But anyway, that's a different story. But fundamentally, I think the issue was Nestle took too much time to respond because their CEO in India was an expatriate. As soon as this problem came, he was asked to keep quiet. He was told that the global CEO will address this problem. The global CEO was away somewhere. It took him a couple of days to actually land up. But by that time, the media was at the doors, hounding them, saying, mothers are saying, this is what I've been feeding my kid for the last so many years. You know, is it unsafe? Is it poisonous? Give us some answers. But I think what everybody suffered, because all said and done, Maggi is like, you don't buy noodles, you actually buy Maggi. In fact, in many stores, they actually call it Maggi ka EP de dena humko. So if Maggi had a problem, everybody assumed that EP will also have a problem. But I think what we did was we responded very quickly. We set up a control room almost immediately. All of us were sitting in front of the computers and answering consumer queries day in and day out. So any query that came to us on Facebook, email, any social media site, any telephone calls which came, we immediately addressed them. We tested our products in multiple government labs, both in India and abroad. We uploaded all these reports onto the website. We told consumers, you can go there, check every single report. If you don't understand something, let us know. We will explain it to you. We invited consumers to our factories to see the way our noodles are made. We made lots of web videos, which we kept uploading on our laboratory, the kind of checks that we do, the kind of labs that we have, the kind of hygiene parameters that go in, the way the raw materials are tested. And I think all this kind of helped strengthen EP's position in the minds of the consumer. So before, I remember EP had a market share of about 15-16% before the Maggi crisis hit us. And Maggi had close to about 78% of the market at that point in time. It took Maggi almost a year, or maybe close to a year, to kind of get back into the market. By the time they came back, redistributed, got everything back in place, started advertising, and the dust settled down. Maggi had come down to about 55% share of the market, and Maggi had moved to about 24-25% share of the market.
Alright, yeah, so that was so faster response, faster response, and again connect with the customer, connect with the consumer. I mean, a much stronger connect with the consumer is what helped. Okay, helped at least arrest.
And I guess especially in the in today's world where social media is so active, and we all know that bad news spreads maybe 10 times faster than good news.
Correct.
Everybody wants to share, you know. Baggy mein problem hai, isme problem hai, etc.
And whether it is true or not, it still gets shared. So even rumors can spread very fast on the platforms. That's the idea. So a company has to be extra alert to take care of all of these things. Correct.
That is right. That is right.
All right. Okay. So interesting. All right. So that was an example of how with a whole lot of relevant marketing actions. A brand has moved from barely, you know, from you know, fighting someone who's 90% market share and actually, you know, pulling out almost 25% market share in a short period of about 3 to 5 years. All right. Great. Great. Anything else? Any other examples that you can share with us, GK? You worked in foods also, right?
One of the largest brands in the foods business is Ashirvad Atta. And I think one of the, although Ashirvad Atta enjoyed very, very healthy shares and is the number one atta brand in the country. I think one of the problems was that the pricing of Ashirvad Atta was still linked to the underlying commodity, which is wheat. Because obviously wheat, the whole product is 100% wheat. and therefore the underlying commodity price had a huge bearing on the price that we could charge the consumer. Because consumers had multiple options. They could buy competition brands, they could buy local brands, they could buy loose atta, they could buy wheat and get it ground in a chakki and then take it home. And therefore, we had to
Interesting. What was, you said, the percentage of raw material, I mean, wheat pricing to the entire product pricing? What was that percentage? 90%?
Almost 75%.
Oh, that's pretty high. I mean, for example, in chocolates, sugar would probably account for barely 35% of the overall sales price. So I think that
even lower. So typically chocolates have about 35-40% of the product is sugar.
Okay.
But sugar is the cheapest ingredient that goes into the chocolate.
Okay. All right.
Cocoa is the
more expensive ingredient in the product. All right.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. So, because of that, we said we needed to find a way by which we are able to isolate some part of the portfolio from the underlying commodity fluctuations. And one of the things that we figured out from the consumer was that in many parts of the country, people add other grains to their atta in order to make it more healthy. So some people added soya, some people add channa, some people add some methi, some people add isabgol, you know, so different kinds of grains kind of go into get mixed along with the atta so that there is some added health benefits that is able to provide, because it's a large staple for many Indians. You know, that is their chief staple, and that occupies the center of the plate. Bulk of the calories or intake actually comes from that, and therefore somewhere inherently the mother or the wife understands that that is the best way to inject added nutrition into their families.
And it also has a very strong emotional link. Garam garam roti banake dena to the family is something which is very important for the mother. Yes.
Absolutely. I mean, it is her time, right? It is the time when she gets to see the family together and kind of take care of all of them together. Yeah, you're absolutely right. It's a highly emotional moment as well. And so using this knowledge, we created a product which is called Ashirvad Multigrain Atta, where we actually kind of mixed five other grains along with wheat and created this whole product. Now, obviously, from a health perspective, it was far more nutritious. But the challenge we faced was from a taste window. So there were two challenges. One is perceived taste and the second is actual taste. Mm-hmm. So one is when you tell consumers that this has got six different grains which are mixed with atta, they say, wow, it's great. But, you know, I can't buy two different attas for the family. I can't buy an atta for me and my husband and my in-laws. And I can't buy a different atta for the kids because I can't give the multigrain atta to the kids. And the second thing is actual taste. So when I taste it, am I able to make up a difference between the roti made from a multigrain atta and the roti made from a regular atta? So first we said, let's crack the real problem, which is the actual taste. So a lot of blending trials went in terms of the proportion of each of the grains and how much percentage we can do and what level of grinding we need to undertake each of those grains for. And finally, I think we, our product development team actually cracked the product, which in a blind form, very few consumers could differentiate between the regular Ashirvad Atta and the multigrain Atta. So that was the first challenge that we managed to overcome.
That was not the good. That's not a good thing, right? I mean, you spend crores of rupees doing some development and the consumer can't even figure out the difference between the two, or you actually wanted it that way?
We wanted it that way because I think even in their regular food, when they add these grains, it is almost a secret addition that the mother does. Most of the times, the rest of the family does not even know that the mother has added the soya or mother has added the channa, or she's added the extra fiber, etc. Because the moment they know it, they're going to say, no, please don't do
it. They won't eat it. That's it.
So it is kind of very
similar. Eating the roti after that.
Correct. No, I'm saying it is very similar to the dehydrated vegetables problem of noodles.
Yeah.
Where the mother needs to know it is there, but the kid needs to kind of figure out that it's not there.
Okay.
So that was the thing. And so people could... So one is at a blind level, people, it was almost as tasty, almost like a Diet Coke versus a regular Coke kind of thing. And the second problem was perception, right? So the moment you say multigrain, etc., So initial campaign was focused more on the health part, but that gave us some level of traction. But then the brand started stagnating because of the barrier to trial, which was that it will not be tasty and I can't buy two different attas at home. Then we created this whole campaign of how multigrain atta can actually be tasty. So rather than just make it like a television campaign, of course, there was one which talked about it. I think we did a lot of other interesting stuff. So we tied up television channels. We tied up with a lot of chefs. So who started making pizzas with multigrain atta, who started making interesting varieties of bread, of different kinds of breads, Indian bread, Western bread, and so on and so forth, saying that it is actually as tasty and you can do it. We asked consumers to send recipes of what they can do with the multigrain atta and so on and so forth. So that whole campaign really took the brand to another level. A lot more consumers started coming in and a lot more consumers started writing to us as well in our website saying that, yeah, I tried your multigrain atta and it's really good. And, you know, it's very, very tasty. It was a pleasant surprise. I didn't think it was going to be that good and so on and so forth. So I think because of that, so now the value-added atta, and we had another product as well called Ashirvad Select. The two of them put together now account for almost 7-8% in terms of volumes on the total Ashirvad portfolio. More importantly, they account for almost 13-14% in terms of value and a much higher number in terms of profits and gross margins.
Okay.
So I think it's really kind of helped to at least some isolate some part of the portfolio or ring fence some part of the portfolio from the underlying commodity pressures.
Yeah, because that I think must be a big challenge in terms of profitability for the foods business, right? I mean, anything that is linked to commodity prices is going to have a deep impact on the, I mean, very easy to increase volumes, but increasing the value realization is a good example, actually.
I think that's the whole challenge. I think in some sense, I think if you look at Prime Minister Modi also has been focusing on that, saying, how do we grow the food processing industry in the country? I think the more we are able to add value to the underlying commodity, whether it's fruits, vegetables, cereals, pulses, millets, etc., then the consumer is willing to pay a higher price, in which case the farmers can now start getting a higher price. Mm-hmm. Because ultimately, if all of this is consumed only in the raw form, I'm only consuming a vegetable as a vegetable or a fruit as a fruit, then there is only so much that the consumer is willing to pay. And consequently, the farmer doesn't get a great price, and we have lots of intermediaries who swallow some more of the price and so on and so forth. So I think if more and more companies start getting into food processing, right, and start adding value to the basic commodity, I think you will see a dramatic transformation in the Indian economy, driven by prosperity in rural India, I think.
Okay. All right. Okay, great. Thanks, GK. I think I want to summarize, you know, there's two things that you highlighted in your entire marketing talk about what is the role of a marketing person. And the first thing I'm highlighting to all our viewers is that there is a huge amount of product development effort that goes into the product before the launch, right? I mean, a lot of us feel marketing is about whatever, segmenting, targeting, positioning, and it's more about running ads, and it's more about, it's a glitzy, glamorous lifestyle. But what you've really highlighted in both the examples that you've given is that that talking to the consumer, making sure you have those discussions which are quality discussions, going back to the factory, redesigning the product, okay, and getting that whole thing right from the point of view of the consumer is actually a key role that a marketing person plays out. The second thing I'm hearing is you said in the Ashirvad Atta example, you took a lot of effort on demand creation, which is that you were talking to influencers, you know, getting the bakeries to start using the products, listening to the consumers, incorporating their feedback. So I guess, we never look at our role as a demand creation kind of a role. We just say, okay, we got to run a series of ads on television and hope that the consumer will go to the retail outlet and pick it up. So I guess, that's an important aspect of the role. Okay, great. All right. I think we've got a few comments from some of our people. All right. So thanks, GK. Some of them are complimenting you. So very inspiring and insightful. That's what Prakash is saying. Okay.
Thank you.
And Mahesh, good. Okay. Thanks for your comment. He says there's been a lot of very small aspects that, attention to detail that that ITC puts in, and that's what is expected of a marketeer. Okay. Any final comments on, we've got a whole lot of aspiring marketeers as a part of our audience here. So what would be your advice to, what is it that they should do to be, successful in this field today? Any quick suggestions, any quick ideas for them?
I think if you can pick up skills more than anything else, I think a lot of it is about, I think marketing, like we discussed right in the beginning, is going to change in future. I think personal selling is going to come back and come back big time. I think somewhere the whole cycle is going to change. I think marketing started with personal selling many years back. Eureka Forbes, AquaGuard made it a big thing at one point in time. Kind of lost it with lots of broadcast media coming in. I think it made marketers a little lazy because broadcast media was available. I could just make an ad and then and reach a lot number of people. But I think the world is turning the other way around. I think increasingly we need to target sharper. We need to focus more. We need to almost sell our products on an individual basis. The mediums could change. And I say personal selling, not necessary that I may need to knock on doors and talk to the consumer, but it could be on the digital platform. It could be on the phone. It could be on the mobile. It could be in any different, it could be in activations. It could be in various different forms. So if you get opportunities to involve yourself in some personal selling project, I think that would be fantastic. So if you get an opportunity to stand in a store and speak to consumers or sell products, or if you get opportunities to do some research, I think that would be great. Please take those up, because I think that will give you a very firm grounding and a very firm foundation of what I think marketing will need going forward. Second thing is any skills in digital.
This will also look very good on their biodatas, because they can show it as additional projects. See, because when a company goes to campus, it actually meets 120 students, all of whom have done some volunteer experience in the, in the couple of national seminars that the college does. But this is one way in which the student can actually differentiate himself by doing these projects. Correct.
Absolutely. Great. Absolutely right. Absolutely right. And the second thing is, if you can pick up any skills in digital. If you can do some of those free online certification courses on Google Analytics, social media analytics, e-commerce, I think a lot of advertising, a lot of commerce, a lot of transactions, sales is increasingly going to happen on digital. And I think if we start understanding that medium better, figuring out various ways in which the medium operates and what are the emerging trends there, and how can marketers use that medium effectively. So anything in that area will also hold you in very good stead. So if there are two things that I think people should look at, would be focus on personal selling at one level, and the second level is pick up skills in the digital arena.
All right. Great. GK, okay. So thanks a lot. I think we've gone way beyond what we had actually intended. All right. So thanks a lot. And look forward to having you, online in further roles. And I'm sure if there are more questions that are coming in, we could get you back again for one more round, some weeks later. All right. So thanks a lot.
Definitely.
All right. Thanks a lot.
Thank you. Okay. Thanks so much, Maneesh, for calling me. And I hope I didn't bore your audience too much.
I don't think so. Based on the comments, I certainly don't think so. All right. So,
okay.
Thanks a lot. And all the best.
Thanks a lot, Maneesh. Bye. And bye, everyone.
All right, everybody. So, So now that GK signs off, okay, here's me back again. All right. So, we've gone on for quite some time today, a little longer than what we had envisaged. And I hope it was a useful session for you. Let me move on. Okay, quickly summarizing. Okay, my name is Maneesh Konkar. We run a channel called directiononeonline.com, which has e-learning programs on sales, marketing, and leadership. We're adding more content every week. GK should be looking forward to professionals like GK joining us and creating more content. All right. Okay, so thanks a lot. In the final part of our webinar today, okay, I wanted to talk about this book called Blitzscaling. Okay, now this is written by the ex-CEO of LinkedIn called Reid Hoffman, and the context that he basically describes is that about 20 years back, okay, most of us when we joined industry, we have grown up on management wisdom of, let's say, a GE, a Toyota. Okay, these were the two companies that were given, you know, that were the examples that were given all the time. Okay, somewhere along the way, things changed. Okay, Facebook came up, Google came up. Today, if you look at the top 10 companies in market capitalization, the tech world is a large segment over there. And whenever you give a tech example to anybody, the standard answer has always been, look, I'm running a manufacturing company, I'm running an automobile company, this doesn't apply to me. Facebook is different, Google is different, this is not me. Okay. What Reid Hoffman talks about in this book is that there is actually a basic business similarity between what Facebook has done, what Amazon has done, what Tesla is doing right now, and what is actually, what has led to the downfall of so many of these old economy companies. Okay, so he starts off by this statement: Uber didn't kill the Kallipillis. He makes another statement: Apple iTunes didn't kill the music industry. He says Netflix didn't kill Blockbuster. Now, what these statements mean, okay, and it takes you a little bit of insight to understand what these statements are. The point was that the music industry forced us to buy CDs. Every CD had about 14, 15 songs. How many songs did you actually like out of those 14 or 15? Probably only one or two. They forced us to buy the entire CD at a higher price. Okay. What Apple iTunes came in and did was they said one song, 99 cents. Okay, and that revolutionized the way the whole music was purchased online. The tech helped along, right? The Kallipillis were giving us lousy service. Even today, most of them continue to give lousy service. And along came Uber and Ola, and actually made the whole travel experience much more convenient. Okay, I remember when we used to catch flights, early morning or late evening flights, most of the time cabs simply were not available or were available at horrendous prices and with a bunch of rude drivers. So tech didn't kill the Kallipillis. Ola and Uber killed the Kallipillis using a tech platform because the Kallipillis were giving poor service. So customer satisfaction continues to be important. It was important 20 years back. It is important today. The book gives a number of examples about how companies have used basic principles and become successful. They appear as tech companies, but what they're following is fundamental business successes. I'd like to give you two examples. The first one is, let's say, Amazon once upon a time was pathetic in supply chain. They used to outsource their entire supply chain to an outside company, which used to take almost 2 weeks to deliver a product. What they did was they said, why don't we make supply chain, which is a negative, which is a weakness in the company right now, and make it into a positive. So they invested in better supply chain technology, came up with an offering called Fulfilled by Amazon, created a network of godowns all across the service area. And when positioned it as Amazon Prime, and that's how you and I are thrilled. I mean, to get a delivery within 2 hours, sometimes for some of the products, and max 24 to 48 hours if you are an Amazon Prime customer, right? Now that's great, okay? Because you actually match the service levels of your local Kirana store. The second thing that I want to point out is that there was a change. So Facebook, in 2006 or 2007, actually did the courageous thing. Mark Zuckerberg did the courageous thing of transferring 2/3 of his developmental team from the web application to the mobile application. And that was because mobile was becoming more and more important as days went along. But look at it. I mean, you've observed a trend in the market. You're not fighting the trend. You're not resisting the trend. But you've actually converted most of your team members and transferred them. That's a pretty courageous thing to do. The book has lots of examples of how these companies have actually managed to survive and grow despite being in such a rapidly changing environment. All right. You can pick up the book. It costs about 350 rupees or so. There's a link in the description, so you can click on that, and we get a few bucks as affiliate commission. That helps us pay the bills. All right. So with that, we come to the end of our talk today. I hope it helped. Okay. Looking forward to you joining in again and again. Again, we are Direction One Online. Okay. Our content is available on this site. You can subscribe for it using the link in the description, or just go to www.directiononline.com and sign up for the monthly subscription. Thanks a lot. Okay. See you next week.